I was born in Jersey City, New Jersey. We didn't have much money. My father had a gambling joint down on Jackson Avenue where bookmakers used to come in, and he lost many businesses because of his addiction to the gambling. But when I was very young and lived in a neighborhood where there were holdups and murders and everything constantly, I'd seen it all where most people even my age now have never seen, you know. It was a mixed neighborhood of blacks and Irish and Italians and Jewish, and it was crazy.
Did the Depression affect your family? Did the Depression affect your family?
No. My father had four brothers and a sister, and they all had come over from Europe early in the century. And they all did well, except my old man, who was busy with his gambling. And they all had great businesses and were very successful. And he struggled. And we lived upstairs above the store. And when I was 10 years old, we left practically overnight because he had fooled around with somebody's big bet and didn't place it where he should have placed it, and they were after him, and we just left town.
This must have affected, did it affect, you know, your school? Did you like school? Was this a...
Well, I went through school fine. Neither liked it or just, I don't remember the early years, but we had lots of fights on the street, I know that. but it was okay. But I think all of that affected the family a little, because when we moved, from Jersey City out to Long Island. My father borrowed some money from his brothers and bought another little store and started the whole thing all over again. You know, it was this, he continuously did that. Yeah, I was brought up with seeing things that most guys never saw and being involved. And
it just sounds like kind of a tough childhood.
I mean, yeah.
What did you... Was there a silver lining? Did you take something away from it? Did it make you a little smarter, a little wiser, a little, you know, that kind of tough background?
Well, later in life you believe it made you wiser, but it made you wiser in things that really don't matter that much. You know, the people and humanity and what they really are, and the dark sides of life. And I saw all that when I was a little kid. Most children never see a thing like that. I remember when I was 9 years old, the most prominent, wealthiest bookmaker in Jersey City put me on his lap one day. He liked me. He used to buy me bicycles and electric trains and everything. He put me on his lap. He says, "I want to tell you something, and I want you to remember it all your life." He said, "Gambling is an evil thing, and we don't let people win. You can't win in gambling. We throw them a bone every now and then, but it's a business, and it's not set up for people to make money on. Don't forget it." I preach that all the time, but people don't want to listen, you know. They like the casinos and the boats and all that stuff and the gambling.
Do you remember what your circumstances were when Pearl Harbor was bombed?
That would have been 1941. I had just graduated from high school, and I had a job in New York City working for one of the major labor unions in the world, the Amalgamated Clothing Workers Union. I got the job because of somebody who lived near us knew that I had a hunger to go to college, and he also knew we had no money. And he met me on the street one day, and he said, "I have a job for you in New York, and I want you to go in, and New York University is only 5 blocks away." So I went in and got the job. I was an errand boy for Sidney Hillman. You probably wouldn't remember the name, but he was president of the Amalgamated Clothing Workers, and during World War II, he was Roosevelt's labor advisor. So I took the job, and I went to school at night, engineering school. And one day, and then, of course, then the war started, and my two buddies and I were walking down the street one day, two high school friends, and I said, let's sign up.
Just like that?
Yeah. So we went down to the recruiting office, and at that time they give you a cursory physical when you're filling out the papers. And I'll never forget it, the sergeant says to me, you're 3 pounds underweight. He said, go home for 2 weeks and eat bananas. And I did and came back and I made the weight. The other two guys went in easily.
What, do you remember how much you weighed? What was the weight?
Yeah, I was, not exactly. I probably was 130 something. You know, I was a skinny kid and working all day and coming home at 11 o'clock at night from school on a train.
Well, did you come back then a little heavier?
Oh yeah. I found an ID card from 1949 when I was back on active duty. And the back of the card says height and weight, and it said weight 150. And I am now 155. That's 50 years ago. They sent me out to Camp Upton, Long Island, which was way out almost to the end of the island. It was a World War I Army base that was boarded up for God knows how many years. And they used that to run the recruits through and issue uniforms and teach you who to salute and who not to salute and things like that. And we were there about, this is an interesting thing, I was telling this story yesterday. We were there about 4 or 5 days. It was in January, and they had us shoveling snow every day. And this corporal would line us up outside the barracks building. We were about 30 of us. And he had this clipboard under his arm, and he'd say, well, we're going to shovel snow this morning. And I wasn't used to that. So we shoveled snow for about 4 days. And the fifth day, he lined us up, and he says, we're going to shovel snow this morning, except for the 4 or 5 men who have appointments to take the air corps test. When he said 4 or 5, I knew damn well he didn't have a list of names. So I stepped out with him, and we marched off. We entered this little school building. I took my tests, went back to my barracks building. The very next day, we shoveled snow again. Then we got word that we were going to ship out the following morning to basic training. So we packed our gear in the morning and sat in the barracks and waited for the train to get ready for us, which was about noon. And they marched us down there, and it was a sergeant with a clipboard checking off names as each one got on the train. And he came to my name and he said, Banner, you're in the Air Corps. That's all there was to it. So they shipped me off to Camp Mills, which was a temporary wooden barracks outside of Mitchell Field, Long Island. Again, just to hold us until we were going to ship out. And we were there about a week or 10 days. And they shipped us to Nashville, Tennessee for classification exams. And 2 days of physical, 2 days of a written test, and then the personal interview. The personal interview was where they washed out most of the guys. They talked to these people trying to find out what their, well, what their makeup was, whether they would fly off the handle, whether they would argue, you know. They really gave me one, I want to tell you. But
they,
I had
did
the
they,
right.
Did they try and provoke you or that kind
of
thing?
Yeah. I sat in front of this old redneck Army captain, Signal Corps captain. It looked like he was drinking 24 hours a day, see. You know, between the wars, those Army officers had nothing to do in those days. This captain was looking up my papers, and he looked up and he said, I see you're Jewish. I said, yes, sir. He said, we don't want Jewish men in the Air Corps. Just like that. And immediately I said to myself, he's baiting me. Because he wouldn't say anything that they didn't tell him not to say. And I said, why is that, sir? He said, well, the Jewish people have been hounded and persecuted for thousands of years and chased around the world. And they've always been on the defensive. We feel they wouldn't make good offensive men. So I sat there about 30 seconds just looking at them. I said, sir, I don't know what your experience has been with individuals. All I know is what I can do. That did it. I mean, he didn't have a word to say. Right. So I went through transitional training, and then when that thing was coming to an end, they called me before a group of officers. It never was easy. And the guy in charge says, it says in your papers here you want to be a navigator. I said, that's right, sir. That was your first choice, navigator. I said, that's right. He said, we need pilots desperately. I said, I want to be a navigator. It was voluntary, see. They couldn't say anything. So I went to navigation school.
Why did you want to be a navigator? It seemed like everybody wanted to be a pilot.
Exactly. That's why I don't tell the story. They don't believe me, really. I was in engineering school. I thought the math involved would really help me as a navigator. And it did a little, you know. So that's why I chose it. I had no idea to go into the Air Corps. I just wanted, because it was part of the Army then, I just wanted to get into service, that's all. You're right, 99% of them want to be a pilot, which I went to later. That's another story. Anyway.
Well, tell me what happened after that.
Well, they shipped us off to Avon Park, Florida, for B-17 training, transitional training. We were there 3 months, getting together as a crew. The bombardiers came from their school, and the navigators came from their school, the pilots, the gunners, the radio operator, and we flew together for 3 months. In B-17s that were war weary and had come back from Europe. And then we got the word that we were going to ship out as a group.
Do you remember what that phase training portion was like, with all the crew getting used to each other, guys from different backgrounds and all that?
We were all the same age except for one man, our co-pilot, and we never could figure how he got to be in the Air Force. He was deaf in one ear. He drank a lot. He was 27 years old, and we were all 19 and 20. We could never figure it out. And he and I became the best of friends. Yeah. He was a great guy. As I say, he was the only older one in the crew. George McKee, who I was sitting with downstairs, was our pilot.
Anything unusual or memorable, something sticks in your mind about phase training, that period?
No, just at the very end. The last 2 days we were there, when they told us the whole outfit was shipping out, my pilot, I was not on this crew, I was on a different crew. And my pilot was a little short captain, a regular Army officer who'd been in for a number of years. And everything with him was spit and polish, yes sir and no sir, and we had a suit on him, you know. And the day before we were to ship out, he went to the base hospital and complained about a million things. And they broke up the crew and he never got overseas, you see. So, so we were at the bar that night, my bombardier and I having a drink, and there was a captain who was an instructor who had come back from Europe, finished his tour, and he and I had gotten pretty friendly. He come over to me. He said, you know, they broke up your crew. You two guys are just sitting here in limbo, and if they need you on another crew early in the morning, you're gone. They're going to take you. Get on the train and go to Miami for a couple of days. So I turned to Lou. I said, let's go. He said, I haven't any money. I said, I don't either. He said, I'll get into a poker game, go to your room, take a nap. When I get enough money, I'll call you. But he never got enough money. They woke me up in the morning, and I was on McKee's crew. I met them on a train. And probably one of the luckiest things that ever happened to me.
Why was that? Or what?
Well, he was fantastic. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, take us from there. Where did it go from there?
Oh, we went to Savannah. It was a 2-day ride by train. It was a troop train. It was a mess. We stopped at a railroad crossing about 4 hours out, and this farmer stopped we went through a crossing, and we stopped there to get locomotive engine, water in the engine or something, right across the tracks, right across the crossing, and a farmer stopped there with a flat body truck loaded with crates full of, what was it? Grapefruit, loaded with grapefruit. Everybody jumped off, not everybody, the guys jumped off the train and stole all the grapefruit and brought it back to the train. And we traveled a day and a half sliding on the floor with grapefruit juice. I felt sorry for that farmer. I'm sure the government reimbursed him, you know. You know, when you realize you're going overseas and there's a war, you do a lot of things that you never would get away with in civilian life. That's what happens, you know. So we got to Savannah. The plan was for us to fly new B-17s over to England. We were in a little compound in the middle of the Hunter Field there with guards and submachine guns all around us. We couldn't go off that little compound. Except that they had a PX right at the edge of it that we could go to. And we waited there about 2 days. We were at the PX one afternoon, and this sergeant approached me, and he said, how would you guys like to go into Manhattan tonight, into New York? I said, we'd love it. Most of us were from New York, you see. And he said, okay, meet me at 7 o'clock here. I'll have a car, and I want six guys, $10 each. So, he had this car, and he drove us through the gate, and then he walked back, and we went into New York, and we met him at 1 o'clock in the morning coming back, and he took the car back. I found out later he had six cars running, and they all belonged to officers on the base. They were all making money on us. Security. As we drove into Manhattan, the Queen Mary was sitting there. I said, there's where we're going, fellas, we're going to England. Queen Elizabeth, rather, we're going to England. Sure enough, we loaded on the Queen Elizabeth the next day.
What do you remember about that journey across in the Queen Elizabeth?
Just a lot of fun. A lot of apprehension. We had submarines chasing us all the way, but they couldn't catch the Queen Elizabeth. So.
Why do you say it was fun?
We did a lot of things on that ship. For instance, we had an Army officer. I still remember his name. It was Du Bois. And he wasn't too bright. And they used the guys who were being shipped over as guards. They put them on all the different decks and told them to watch out for certain things and like security people. So I put a note on his pillow one day. I said, stand guard on C deck from midnight to late in the morning. And he did. He didn't know who wrote the note. We did a lot of crazy things, yeah. But there wasn't much of it going over. Most of it was on the way back. But anyway, we had 17,000 men on board that ship, and that was a lot. You read reports today about the Queen Elizabeth taking troops over. They talk about 14, 15,000. We had 17,000. We pulled into Greenock. I started to tell you that before we started all this. We pulled into Greenock, which is Glasgow, and the ship couldn't get into that dock. So we pulled into Greenock, which is a little island there, and the little boats transported us all into the main railroad station in Glasgow. And there was a huge troop train waiting there for us. And there was a Scottish bagpiper outfit playing for us. They were marching up and down the platform playing music for us. I jumped out of the train and I grabbed the baton and I was leading them up and down the platform. What they did was drop replacement crews off at various bases. So it took about a day in that train to get to where we were going, down in Framlingham. And they moved my crew, the officers slept in one area, the enlisted men were down the road in more of a barracks. And the ablutions building, where you would shave and shower and wash up, was halfway between both, maybe a tenth of a mile or something. And it was in March, it was colder than hell over there, you know.
Is that when you got over March of what year?
44, yeah. And we managed, though. We managed to get along. What
was life like on the base and in the hut? And I mean, give us a sense of that.
Well, I thought of that a lot lately because we never really mingled with other crews and other people. There was no time for that. The people who went over with the original cadre, they were the ones who were like a clique. They stuck together, all the brass, and I assume that they became very close. They were there for 3 or 4 years. And we were there for 6 months, finished the missions, and get out. Could have stayed. They gave us an option of staying there, and they promised us we would not have to fly any more combat missions. But very few of us believed it. So, you know, the first chance we had, we got out. They gave us a 48-hour furlough every 4 or 5 missions to do what we wanted. We went to London, at least I did. Couldn't wait to get off the train and get involved. And we had a great time down there.
What was wartime London like? I mean, were there people on the streets? Was it war? I mean, was it clearly wartime?
Well, you know, you go in a country out where Framlingham was, you know, it was out in the country and it was a village. There were little villages. I still go there. Each crew was issued 2 bicycles, and on the off days we could get a bike and go where we wanted. And the people went about their business, farming and doing what they had to do. And it was you fell in love with England in those little country villages. And then, of course, we took those 48-hour deals to London, and that was different. Yes, the people were on the street. They were working. The buzz bombs were coming over constantly and falling all over the place. And at night, of course, everything was blacked out. Well, all of England was blacked out. There were no lights. Here I go with the funny stuff. And the bobbies on the street in London, the policemen, were working with the hookers. And you could get a hooker for $10 and a bottle of booze for $10. And go to your hotel room. They got half of it, I suppose. I don't know. But it was a game, it really was, you know. But, you know, part of that was just letting the steam off for us. We rented a suite of rooms at an old hotel on, Rathbone Place, right off of Piccadilly. It was an old, old hotel. It was a series of brownstones that were all put together, each with its own individual entrance. You go to the main office, get the key, and it was yours for the 48 hours. And there was a heater on the floor that gave you heat. But you had to feed a quarter in about every 15 minutes, you see. It interrupted a lot of things, but that's beside the point.
Did you ever go down into the subway, into the underground?
Oh, constantly.
What was your experience? What did you see?
Well, they lived down there. The people, you had to step over them, that's all, you know.
Do you remember if that had an impression on you? Like, wow.
Well, we were told about that before we left, but, well, sure, it's a gruesome thing, you know.
You were talking about the buzz bombs. Did you see any when you were in London?
Oh, sure, they used to pass overhead, and if they were still running, you were safe. If they stopped, forget it. They'd come right down on you, you know. You know. There were a couple that were very, very bad, with the anti-aircraft and the fighters and everything, very bad. Well, we lost a lot of airplanes. There were some that we called milk runs, where we had a railroad crossing to bomb or something. And these were the latter part of my days there when the Luftwaffe was practically annihilated, you know. Except for the anti-aircraft, it was a pretty nice run. Of course, D-Day stands out above all, you know.
Talk about the D-Day runs, if you could.
We ran two missions that day. We ran one right past the shore, past the coast, to bomb a German group that was there. We had a malfunction. We didn't drop the bombs. We came back. We ran one in the afternoon to bomb again another railroad crossing deeper into France. And that was okay because, see, by then we had no Luftwaffe opposition. We saw two German airplanes that day, that's all. And they saw us and they went home. In fact, it was written up in many stories about that. The anti-aircraft was pretty heavy. We got back a second mission, and there was a lot of commotion at our operations room. Everybody was running around, and we couldn't figure out what had happened. We had bombed an area in France, and there was an American general, General Leslie McNair, and his troops. And not only our group, but all the groups who bombed there, wiped him and his whole group out. We killed them all, you see. So they were trying to pin it on somebody, but they couldn't. And it was unfortunate. I didn't find out until 10 years ago, at one of our reunions, the guy who organized the reunion had a next door neighbor who was an aide, a colonel who was an aide to General Bradley. He came and spoke to us. And when he was finished, I went up and asked him about General Leslie McNair, about how we killed him. I said, I understand. We wiped out General McNair and his whole group, all his aides. And this colonel got furious. He said, General McNair didn't have any aides. He was sent over by the Pentagon as an observer, and he was 5 miles beyond where they told him to go. So, you know, I felt better with that one. Yeah.
Was there occasions where you'd go in on a mission and you lost engines?
We never lost an engine.
Were there any missions where crew members were injured?
Well, we lost our ball turret gunner the first mission, but he wasn't with us. They assigned it to another crew, and they went down. Oh. Yeah. So we got a new ball turret gunner who had been working in the photo lab on the base. He gave me so many negatives and pictures of things, it's unbelievable. Then, of course, we ran the shuttle runs.
Can you talk about those, please?
Yeah. The first one, we did not go on. And I'm glad we didn't, because the night they landed in Russia, after bombing the docks in Gdynia in Poland, they went over to Russia. And they were having a good time that evening somewhere, and the German Air Force had one plane follow them all the way from the North Sea, all the way across. He saw where they landed, and he reported it. And that night, the Luftwaffe came over and destroyed 50 B-17s. They wiped all of us out. I wasn't there.
This is at Poltava?
Well, we landed at Poltava. Yeah, both times we landed at Poltava. But the second time they were smart. They didn't line up the planes. They dispersed them all over the place. But the Luftwaffe never came over that time. See.
When you went over on the shuttle run, did you see any of the damaged aircraft from the first time? Or had it all been cleared?
Yeah, there was nothing there. There was about a month apart between both missions, yeah. The Russians were not helpful.
Did you have any experience with the Russians when you did the shuttle run?
Only something comical, that's all. When we landed there, we landed in a little town called Mirgorod, which was near Poltava. And the town had recently moved the German army out of there, only for possibly a couple of weeks. And the second day we were there, we loaded up and helped the Russian army by bombing the German troops 50 miles away. There was a schoolhouse there, an old burned out schoolhouse, where they had a bar. The Russians had a bar for the army, for the officers. We were living in a schoolhouse. They put up cots in a schoolhouse. and there was no sanitation or anything. They had dug a long trench in the earth and put boards over it, and that was our sanitation, you know. We went over to get a drink at that little so-called pub, and the Russian officers all hung around begging us to buy them a drink. They had no money at all. So, so anyway, the following day we left, and we had to go to, we had to bomb the oil fields in southern France there in Romania, the Ploiești oil fields. Of course, the original bombing was done 6 months before, a year before that, by the 15th Air Force from Africa, but they wanted us to hit it on the way down, and we did. And we landed at Foggia in Italy. In fact, something happened that no one ever knew. I better not tell you. They'll put me in jail.
Does it matter 60 years later?
Okay, I guess I'm immune now. But we were flying on that one leg across the Alps from Russia to Italy, and I guess we were number two in our formation. My bombardier wanted to write a letter, so he asked me if he could use my desk, and I went up and sat in the nose, and he sat at the desk, and then we got the word to test fire our guns because we were coming into enemy territory. And you know, the chin turret in a B-17 is a remote thing. The triggers are up here. So I was reading something and he was writing a letter, and I pulled the triggers and shot the guns. And I looked out later and they were facing directly at the lead plane. I don't know how I ever missed them. No one ever knew that story.
We won't tell.
No, I don't. Anyway, we landed at Foggia, and it was desolate there because the Germans had just recently been pushed out of there. The buildings were all pockmarked and had holes in them, and there was practically nothing there. We hitchhiked into town, into Manfredonia, looking for a place to eat lunch, and all we found was spaghetti somewhere. That was all. And I have little pictures of that. We took a lot of pictures of that. And there was a little cart coming along with a donkey, and it was a British officer sitting, getting a hitchhiking ride. So two of us got on a cart with him. And he had a primitive swagger stick with him that he'd cut off a tree and shaved it down. And I took it. I still have it. Anyway, we were there about 2-3 days. I want to tell you, the people in Italy, in those towns, they're dirty. They're just dirty. I'm not talking about sanitation. They're dirty. We were standing there waiting for the bus to go back to the base, and this Italian guy standing next to me waiting for the bus, all of a sudden he starts to urinate. And there's 50 people on the street. No, it was an American soldier. And I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "If they can do it, I can do it." We finally went on our third leg, bombing something down in Toulouse, France. I forget what it was, a factory or something. From there, we went home to England. It was quite a deal. On that whole trip, I kept track of all my coordinates on my log. Every turn we made, every place we stopped, all the targets. And just a year ago, I went to one of the air bases. I got a hold of the operations officer. We went in the map room, and I got a nice big map of that part of Europe. And I laid it all out, and I brought it in and had it framed. It's on the wall. It's just beautiful. It's this big. You know. I don't know if anybody will ever see it, but I have it.
Are there other missions that stand out for you?
Well, there are a couple of bad ones. Yeah, I mean, we had one where the group left late, and by the time we started home from Germany, it was dark out. And, you know, as I said, everything was blacked out in England. I don't know how we made it back, but we did. We were talking about that yesterday. He was telling me that we actually, for a while, were going the wrong way. And he told me that I corrected our pilot. and we finally made it in. But when we landed and got out of the plane and we looked around, there wasn't one antenna still on a plane. It had all had been shot away. So we were really lucky, you know. Yeah. But those things, you know, we saw mid-air collisions constantly. You know, we saw guys who couldn't make it in and landed on a runway and blew up, and it happened all the time. But everybody takes that differently.
How did you handle it?
Well, it was an awful thing to see, but you're thinking of the next day. You're thinking of the next day. That's all about your mission, and he's gone, the guy's gone. A lot of those guys came back. They were evades or they were prisoners of war, and they came back.
Were you conscious as you were getting closer to the 35?
Well, of course. I have a photo I took that a time towards the end of my tour when my ears got infected and I was in the hospital for a week. The crew went on without me, of course, so they finished their mission, some of them, and I still had four or five to go, so they put me on a different crew each day, you see. But I have a photo that someone took of George McKee, our pilot, and Al, and Al's brother Ted. They were both on the crew, and our radio man. That day, they finished their last mission, and we took a picture of it. Hmm. I have it hanging in my den. Yeah, it's quite a picture. I have 85 things hanging up at home on the walls. My daughter thinks I'm crazy. I live alone in an apartment. There isn't a space left on the walls except the kitchen. Well, after the war, I also was involved in a lot of things. So.
Well, tell me either about the last mission or immediately thereafter.
Well, of course, when you finish, it's a letdown, a real letdown. You know, I shouldn't put it that way. It's a relief. You're always wondering what the last one's going to be like. Is it going to be a tough one or an easy one? Mine happened to be an easy one. We went across to Holland and bombed something and came back, you know. But you really had no right to think and worry about those missions. You had to do it, and if you didn't make it, you know, you didn't make it, that's all. I think everybody thought that way. There were some guys who couldn't handle it. Al just told me about one of our waste gunners, and I never knew this, because on a mission I never got into the back. He would cover himself with blankets and flak suits and everything, and shoot his gun lying on the side of the plane instead of standing up. He was afraid he was going to get hit. So everybody's different, you see.
Were there guys on the aircraft that were superstitious, you know, had little things they did or any
Not
of that stuff?
Not on our plane, no. Uh-uh. There were some funny incidents. I don't know if you want those. Mm-hmm. Our co-pilot, Doug Grant, I forget the sequence, but we were flying along just before we got into enemy territory. And when you got up at altitude, the relief tubes we used, there was one in a nose and there was one in a waist, and I think just the two of them. And you know what that is.
It's where you used to go to the bathroom.
Yeah. But when you're up at altitude, after you did urinate, they would freeze up in there, so the next guy got it all in his face. It came back at him. Well, that we were flying along, and Doug, the co-pilot, had to do that, and he didn't want to get out of his seat, so he picked up his helmet and did it in the helmet. Half hour, an hour later, we're in the midst of heavy concentrations of flak and so forth, and he forgot about it, and he put the helmet on. We never let him forget it. And poor old George had to sit there for 4 hours with him that way. You know? We went home on a Queen Mary. So I had a great adventure in my life going over on a Queen Elizabeth and coming back on the Queen Mary. We had on board, on a Queen Mary coming back, about 2,000 pregnant nurses and about 1,000 pregnant wacks. We were bringing them home. And Fred Astaire and Bing Crosby were on a ship.
Okay.
And we asked them if they would put on a little show for us. And Crosby couldn't wait, and Fred Astaire refused. He was afraid if the ship rocked, he'd break a leg, and that was the end of his career, you see. We understood that. So we were coming into New York Harbor, and the guys were climbing all over the ship. There were two of them up on a mast, and I was like one of the monitors that day. So I asked him to come down, and Crosby says, "Let him stay up there." I said, "Okay." So we let him stay. Yeah. It was a fun trip coming back. I forgot to tell you that I had about 5 or 6 missions to go, and we were two planes were assigned one day to fly over to another base and bring Glenn Miller and his whole band over. And they put on a show at our base in the hangar on Saturday night, and I didn't even go. I stayed home and rested.
How come? You're just too tired?
Yeah. I mean, I was tired for a couple of reasons. The missions, of course, and my times in London, and I was just tired. And watching this was a thrill for these guys. They never had anything. It wasn't a thrill for me. That's all.
So you're on the ship, Bing Crosby is crooning, and you're on your way. What anything else about that journey across that you remember?
No, pretty uneventful. But of course, there still was that class distinction because we were on a British ship, and the officers were in the top decks, and the enlisted men were way downstairs somewhere, you know. We had to run it by British rules. But there was one thing I forgot about. As we were pulling into the New York Harbor, there was a master sergeant who was permanent cadre on a ship. He went back and forth the whole war and ran the military help on the ship. We had about 5,000 people on that ship. He came into all the rooms and he said, "You know, when we hit New York at the docks, New York Customs is going to run all over you guys. If you're carrying a gun, a 45 or something, put it in the footlocker out in the hall, otherwise you're in deep trouble." There was no customs. Every trip he went home with hundreds and hundreds of 45s. I'm telling you, there was some guys operated even in wartime, you know. No, they gave us a month off or so, and I stayed home. And then I had a report to Ellington Field, Texas, where they pooled all the World War II European navigators who finished their missions. They pooled them all there with nothing to do in case they needed us for the Pacific. And this was late 1944, October 44. I had a base commander at Ellington who, and it was Colonel Harbeck, he had a girlfriend in Houston. And he went out every Saturday night to see her, you see. And his girlfriend had a 21-year-old daughter who was in the way. So Colonel Harbeck used to get into the staff car on a Saturday, get down the main street of Houston past the Rice Hotel, and if any of the lieutenants were standing there, he would order them to get in the car, one guy, to take care of the daughter for the evening. He declared officers' quarters inadequate on the base, and he gave us our extra living allowance to live in town. I lived in a hotel downtown. It was really a lot of fun. We had nothing to do. We had to sign in 3 mornings a week and then get on a bus and go into town. So, you know, I pretty well covered the city of Houston. I really did. But I got tired of that after about 3 or 4 months. And I applied for pilot training, and I went off to pilot school in Florida. And I was about 2/3 of the way through primary. The war was coming to an end, and and they cut the program in half, and I was one of the half that they, you know, I never made it. So I went back to Houston and resumed my good times. That's all.
I realize there's a lot more of this, your the story of your military background, that kind of thing, but just generally, why did you decide to stay in?
I think of that all the time, and I really honestly feel it was my patriotism.